Welcome. My name is Bill Carroll. I'm the president of the World Federation of Neurology, and it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you to this World Brain Day 2021 webinar titled Stop Multiple Sclerosis. World Brain Day represents a celebration of the foundation of the World Federation of Neurology on July 22, 1957. The mission of the World Federation of Neurology is to foster quality neurology and brain health worldwide. This is the 8th annual World Brain Day. In recent times, with each World Brain Day, the World Federation of Neurology has focused on a specific disease and has been fortunate to partner with a member of the Global Neurology Alliance, such as the International Headache Society, the World Stroke Organization, the International League Against Epilepsy, and most recently, the International Parkinson's Disease and Movement Disorder Society, to mention a few. The campaign, the World Brain Day campaign, extends from the 22nd of July through to the World Congress of Neurology in early October. This year, we are delighted to have the Multiple Sclerosis International Federation join with us. This webinar features a series of presentations about the important facts for MS, each of which will be introduced by Professor Tissa Wijeratna, Chair of the World Federation of Neurology World Brain Day Committee. Over to you, Tissa.
My name is Tissa Wijeratna. I am the Chair, World Brain Day, World Federation Neurology. You might wonder, why should we care about multiple sclerosis while we are in the middle of a pandemic due to COVID-19? Well, multiple sclerosis, as you probably know, is increasing its prevalence globally in several countries. If you look at global burden disease data set from 1996 to 2016, number of countries, the number of people living with multiple sclerosis doubled. This is alarming. When you look at Multiple Sclerosis International Federation iterations from 2013 to latest iteration, the number of people living with multiple sclerosis in 2013 was reported as 0.3 million people, whereas the latest iteration show the number of people living with multiple sclerosis 2.8. Some even say that this is a pandemic within pandemic. Let me remind you that the mean age of someone somewhere who get this devastating diagnosis during the prime of their life, while they are graduating, while they are trying to get married, while they are trying to establish a family, while they're trying to set up their finances, is 32 years of age. That's the sort of a real prime of a human being's life. It is also worth remembering that once every 5 minutes, someone somewhere, irrespective of your color or region where you live in, the language that you speak, you get a diagnosis of multiple sclerosis. World Federation Neurology is delighted to be able to partner with Multiple Sclerosis International Federation and many other global the neurological organizations that are commonly known as Global Neurological Alliance to run the most ambitious World Brain ever. We want you to join us. We want you to help us to stop multiple sclerosis. You would hear from other speakers the cutting edge treatment and some of the fantastic ways that we can deal with disorder and some of the issues that our colleagues are facing in different parts of the countries. So you could do your part by using your media, whatever it is, whether it is Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, just type World Brain Day 2021. I support World Brain Day. I endorse World Brain Day. Let's work together to stop multiple sclerosis through the most successful global advocacy campaign ever to promote brain health. We sincerely hope that you join our campaign to stop multiple sclerosis as these young people deserve better. Let's join this ambitious World Brain Day campaign. Let's promote brain health. Let's support and endorse World Brain Day. Get your device, whatever the device that you have, just type right now that you support World Brain Day, you endorse World Brain Day, you support the ambitious World Brain Day campaign to stop multiple sclerosis. There will be many more activities after this webinar. Please tune in, visit World Federation Neurology website, visit Multiple Sclerosis International Federation website. This pandemic has shown us that by working together, collaboration, collegiality, there's nothing that we cannot achieve. So let's be the confident that we can indeed stop multiple sclerosis by working together. And I count on you. Please support us. Endorse World Brain Day. Support World Brain Day. Let's stop multiple sclerosis once and for all.
Hi, my name is Cherie Celestino. I've been working within neurology as a clinical trials coordinator for almost 15 years. In the last few years, we have coordinated a few MS trials dating back to when there was only two treatment options available. Early this year, I received a diagnosis of multiple sclerosis. When my symptoms first came on, I recognized that it could be MS. Despite this, when I received the official diagnosis, I was still in complete shock. I felt vulnerable. When I sat with the reality that my own immune system had attacked my spine and my brain, it was very confronting and I was riddled with fear. That fear prevented me from looking into the current literature. It prevented me from reading into the current treatment options. Thankfully, I'm surrounded by my amazing physician, colleagues, and friends who reminded me how far MS treatment has come, how far research has come, making this condition a potentially very manageable one. And so that fear that I had in those initial stages had moved into hope. I'm now completely hopeful that with where the research is going, that MS for the, you know, 2 or so million people like myself living with this condition, that it will be a thing of the past. Thank you for listening.
It is my pleasure and honor to introduce the next speaker, who doesn't need an introduction to the multiple sclerosis community. Nonetheless, as part of the proceeding, I'm delighted to bring this speaker to you. Our next speaker is Professor Mai Shave. She is the professor of neuro-ophthalmology at Cairo University. She is also the co-founder of Multiple Sclerosis Care Egypt, and she is also the chair of the board of Multiple Sclerosis International Federation. Professor Mai Shave will talk to us about the disability and multiple sclerosis. Over to you, Professor Shave.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. My name is Mai Sharawi. I'm a professor of ophthalmology at Cairo University. I'm also the co-founder of MS Care Society of Egypt. This is the first patients organization for any disease in the country. But I'm here because I'm the president chair of the board of Multiple Sclerosis International Federation, MSIF. It's heartwarming to celebrate World Brain Day with the World Federation of Neurology at times of uncertainty and isolation with the theme of Stop Multiple Sclerosis. MS is a lifelong degenerative disease that affects the central nervous system, that is the brain, spinal cord, and the optic nerves. People with MS experience a wide range of symptoms, blurring of vision, pain, reduced mobility, cognitive impairment, and fatigue. These symptoms are different from one person to the other. That's why it's often referred to as a disease of 1,000 faces. It is also the heavy guest that visits people at the beginning of their career lives, when they start families, to bring uncertainties, invisible symptoms, financial burden, and even social stigma in some communities. We are here to stop all that. Worryingly, the Atlas of MS shows that there are many barriers in accessing a diagnosis across the world. From a scarcity of knowledgeable healthcare professionals, a lack of understanding of MS symptoms among both the general population and healthcare professionals, together with barriers to accessing the diagnostic tests as well. Even in best practice setting, diagnosis of MS is never an easy job. Because of the diversity of symptoms and similarity with many other autoimmune diseases, and this adds to the delay in diagnosis and hence the accumulation of disabilities. An early diagnosis is vital to ensure prompt treatment and change of lifestyle to minimize relapses and reduce future disability so that people with MS can live their best lives. The researchers and the medical community from around the world invested a lot in bringing about medicines that changed the face of MS, reducing the accumulation of MS attacks and hence reducing the disability. But people enjoy this in countries where these medicines are available and affordable, while in other places around the world, people with MS have no access to these medicines. In the MSIF movement, researchers from USA, Uruguay, Lebanon, Italy, and Japan, they speak the same language because they share a vision of a world without MS. The movement brought together researchers from 19 countries to form an alliance, the Progressive MS Alliance, to understand, prevent, and even reverse progression in MS. By determining what triggers MS progression, researchers will be better prepared to focus their efforts on developing breakthrough to slow, prevent, and ultimately reverse progression, bringing hope for all living with a disease. The current pandemic has highlighted for everyone that life can be so complicated and unpredictable. People living with MS already know that because they have lived their whole lives with symptoms that come and go, invisible symptoms such as fatigue, brain fogging, and even pain that take much of their energy and make day-to-day tasks difficult. Unfortunately, people with MS cannot always get the help they need when they need it. And there is high unmet need in the area of rehabilitation and symptomatic management. The situation is undoubtedly made worse by the pandemic, where services have been reduced or cut. World Brain Day is a wake-up call to the decision makers, politicians, economists, pharma industries, medical community, and even the public to help people with MS to live well by removing the barriers to diagnosis, access to treatments, and to ensure that they can stay on their medications. In World Brain Day, we're not only stopping MS as a disease, we're also striving to stop inequality in management of people living with MS according to where they live, their healthcare condition in their country, socioeconomic status, sometimes gender or even color. We are fighting against discrimination in a world where people with MS may be subjected to even more discrimination because of their needs. Every story of a person with MS and a family living with a person with MS is a story of struggle. These stories urge us all to work fast and to work together to bring a happy ending to these stories. Happy World Brain Day, and thank you for having me.
Thank you so much, Mai, for that brilliant presentation. The many of our colleagues and the patients and support groups were enlightened by your brilliant talk. It is my pleasure and honor to bring the next speaker to this esteemed audience. We got Professor Brenda Banville, who is the Chief of Child Neurology and Professor of Neurology and Pediatrics at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia and Perelman School of Medicine, University of Pennsylvania. She is the chair of Multiple Sclerosis International Federation, International Medical and Scientific Board. Brenda will talk to us about the importance of education. Over to you, Professor Banville.
Hello, everyone. My name is Brenda Banwell. I'm the Chief of Neurology at the Children's Hospital of Philadelphia, and I also serve as the chair of the International Medical and Scientific Advisory Board for the Multiple Sclerosis International Federation, and as the chair for the International Pediatric Multiple Sclerosis Working Group. And so in these various capacities, I am extremely delighted to speak with you about multiple sclerosis, the diagnosis, management, and priorities for the World Federation of Neurology and the World Health Organization in advocacy and support for persons living with multiple sclerosis. So first of all, what is multiple sclerosis? Multiple sclerosis is an acquired demyelinating disease of the central nervous system with a prominent inflammatory component directed by immune cells that target, among others, areas in the brain, perivenular white matter, cortical white matter, and deep gray white matter in both the brain, spinal cord, and optic nerve. In the majority of patients, multiple sclerosis is a relapsing, remitting disease characterized by episodes of acute neurological dysfunction, followed by periods of clinical remission from attack, but also complicated by pervasive features of fatigue, a risk for cognitive impairment, risk for spinal cord symptoms, including weakness, sexual dysfunction, bowel and bladder dysfunction, in some patients by episodes of pain and discomfort, and in all patients by a significant impact in their quality of life. About 20% of patients living with multiple sclerosis will experience primary progressive disease, which has fewer and sometimes no clear relapses, but rather more progressive neurological disability. And in patients with the relapsing form of the disease, after years of their condition, some patients also enter into a secondary progressive phase of the disease, where disability worsens even when relapses are less common. Multiple sclerosis is an age span diagnosis. Patients can present as young as 2 or into their late 60s. Very importantly, multiple sclerosis is a worldwide disease, with multiple sclerosis, as illustrated by the MS Atlas, being a disease of all individuals worldwide in all communities. Women are more likely to have multiple sclerosis than men, particularly in the teenage and young adult years. Multiple sclerosis is diagnosed both, and importantly, first of all, based on clinical presentation. So a person experiencing an initial event or neurological findings consistent with demyelination of the optic nerve, such as optic neuritis, spinal cord, which presents with myelitis, or with symptoms referable to the cerebrum. The diagnosis is supported by cerebral spinal fluid evidence of chronic immune activation, which is evidenced by oligoclonal bands that are present in spinal fluid, but not in serum. And very importantly, multiple sclerosis is supported by findings on imaging. Brain MRI and spinal cord MRI have greatly enhanced our ability to make the correct diagnosis and to do so promptly. In multiple sclerosis diagnostic criteria, the distribution of areas of inflammation in the central nervous system, which include lesions in the juxtacortical area, lesions in the periventricular region, brainstem and spinal cord lesions, are the distribution in space, or the distribution of lesions most commonly seen in multiple sclerosis. And then importantly, we look for evidence that these lesions have occurred at different times, in one way supported by some of the lesions enhancing after the administration of gadolinium and others that don't, or by the accrual over time of new lesions and or new clinical attacks. With the ability to incorporate spinal cord brain imaging as well as cerebral spinal fluid oligoclonal band findings combined with the clinical presentation, the diagnosis of multiple sclerosis can be conferred at the time of the first attack, provided that the MRI appearance meets the criteria for multiple sclerosis in terms of pattern and distribution, and certainly also aided by the presence of oligoclonal bands in the spinal fluid. Why does this matter? Well, we do know now, and over the last decade, we have certainly had many lines of evidence that support that treatment early matters. Suppression of clinical attacks, shutting down new lesions from appearing on the imaging, and supporting persons living with multiple sclerosis with wellness strategies to reduce some of the other features of this disease play a pivotal role in quality of life in the moment and in reducing the risk of future disability in the long term. Prompt treatment and a prompt diagnosis provides someone living with multiple sclerosis with the information they need to advocate for their care. And certainly worldwide, the ability to make the diagnosis correctly and rule out other diagnoses is essential in order to provide the appropriate treatment strategies. Which brings me to an important point of advocacy. There are now in many countries worldwide over 15 to 18 approved multiple sclerosis immune modulatory therapies. However, all of these therapies are not uniformly available in all countries. In many parts of the world, the choices are very limited. And in other parts of the world, even when those medications are available, the ability to gain access to those therapies is restricted or requires a variety of very difficult steps in order to gain access for patients to currently available and proven therapies that have been shown in clinical trials to greatly improve the disease course of individuals with multiple sclerosis. So a very important question as to what the World Federation of Neurology and the WHO can do is to facilitate advocacy for uniform and more equitable access, both for treatment strategies, but also for expertise in training clinicians in each country in the appropriate ways to diagnose multiple sclerosis in children, young adults, and older adults. In addition, there are other healthcare providers that are pivotal to the care of someone living with multiple sclerosis. These include therapists, nutritionists, social workers, psychologists, psychiatrists, and others, nursing pivotal among them, who as a team work with physicians and advanced care providers to optimize a comprehensive care strategy for multiple sclerosis. Wellness in multiple sclerosis or in any other health condition is not the absence of the illness. Wellness is itself a therapy. So healthy weight, exercise, mental health support, nutritional support in multiple sclerosis, vitamin D supplementation, which is important because low vitamin D levels have been shown both to be a potential risk factor for the disease and potentially a modifiable factor for diseased course, avoidance of smoking, and overall healthy choices can dramatically improve the overall wellness of a person living with multiple sclerosis. And many of these facets are also important to their family and loved ones. Living with someone who has a chronic neurological diagnosis has a toll on the family, and family counseling, parent support, if a child is living with multiple sclerosis, support for spouses or care providers and extended family goes a long way in helping everyone in the family deal with, support, and maximize the quality of life of someone living with multiple sclerosis. So I'd like to end by congratulating everyone on World Brain Day and to again thank the World Federation of Neurology for the opportunity to speak to you. To again call out the WHO and its role in advocacy for healthcare access and equity, and to all of you for listening. So thank you and enjoy the rest of the World Brain Day.
Thank you, Professor Branwell, for that enlightening speech. As you can see, education is power and education is critically important for us to get this job done and stop multiple sclerosis. Make sure that you support our campaign. It is my great pleasure to introduce the next speaker who really doesn't need any introduction to the World Federation Neurology or Multiple Sclerosis community, as this name is household name for neurology community as well as multiple sclerosis community. Professor William Carroll is the president of World Federation Neurology. He is a senior consultant neurologist at the Department of Neurology and Neurophysiology at Sir Charles Garden Hospital. And he is also a senior scholar and senior professor at Perrin Institute, which is a very well-known research institute in Asia-Oceania region. Fondly known as Bill, had dedicated his life to promote neurological education and promote better care for multiple sclerosis, not only in Australia, not only in Asia, Oceania region, worldwide. He will talk to us about the access to treatment and issues related to this, which is a very timely and painful topic to talk about. Over to you, Professor William Carroll.
Thank you, Tissa. I'm going to speak to you, as Tissa has mentioned, about access to treatment for multiple sclerosis. We call the treatments disease-modifying therapies because they alter the course of the disease. This first slide shows what used to happen in terms of the natural history of the disease, which we heard a little bit about from Dr. Banwell. The world of MS has been transformed by the steady succession of ever increasingly effective disease-modifying treatments. Highly effective treatments can not only suppress the disease and reduce the amount of disability accrual, but in some instances result in reversal, that is improvement over a period. And this slide with CARE-MS2 on the left and the right shows the reduced amount of worsening and the increased amount of improvement some 9 years after receiving the highly effective alemtuzumab treatment, with another drug called Tysabri or natalizumab shows the same, that is, confirmed disability worsening was only affecting some 28% at the end of 10 years, and a third of patients actually improved over that 10-year period. The tragedy is that while such treatments are widely available, they are relatively restricted and inaccessible, even in some high-income countries. The situation is worse in low and low-middle-income countries. Next slide shows this from the World Federation of Neurology Needs Registry Survey. You can see in the top line, low-income countries, of 12 of them, none of them have any of the available disease-modifying therapies, not even the older injectables, whereas the high-income countries have, most of those countries have all of them or many of them available. The prohibitive cost of these medication is the primary barrier to the widespread accessibility, and this barrier condemns people with MS in many low and low middle income countries to levels of disability no longer seen in more affluent countries. On the right of this slide, you can see that the cost of any new drug is prohibitive at something like $2.9 billion. On the left-hand side, you'll see this yellow line rising exponentially up as time progresses along the lower axis. This is an older MS treatment in the US. The price of this drug has risen for something like less than $10,000 a year to more than $60,000 a year, and that is still being sold today. This is the tragedy that people with MS in low and low middle income countries face. The challenge for all of us is to identify and render available a range of effective treatments in the same way as COVID-19 vaccines are distributed. Multiple Sclerosis International Federation, with the World Federation of Neurology and your help, must advocate vociferously for the World Health Organization, governments, and pharma to develop supply and distribution chains to those excluded from effective disease-modifying treatments. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Bill. I take this opportunity to thank and offer our sincere gratitude for your tremendous leadership last decade or so, and in particular during last 4 years that I had to do a fair bit for the World Brain Day campaign. Thank you so much for your contribution. It is my pleasure to introduce the next speaker to you. Professor Wolfgang Grisold had been a household name in neurology and neurological advocacy for a long period of time. I had the pleasure of working with Professor Grisold on advocacy for well over a decade on common themes. There is no other speaker to talk about this topic other than Professor Grisold. He has written a very popular book on neurology and advocacy, which is available for you to read. Strongly recommend if you were to be the best advocate for your patients wherever you are. Professor Wolfgang Grisold is the Secretary General of World Federation of Neurology, and he is a key senior member of the Advocacy and World Brain Day Committee. And it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Grisold to talk about advocacy and why it is such an important issue in the journey of getting this job done and stop multiple sclerosis. Over to you, Professor Grisold.
Thank you, Tisa, for this kind introduction, and good day to all of you. My name is Dr. Wolfgang Grisold. I'm a neurologist from Vienna, Austria. I've been working for the World Federation for some time, and I've seen the growing of the World Brain Day, which has become a great occasion for the World Federation to promote diseases and interest in diseases. For MS, one can say that we can stop MS by diagnosing earlier, providing better access to life-changing treatments, advocating for improving the quality of life for those living with MS and their caregivers. Advocacy means literally to speak for someone and can be done as levels for a single individual or for a global issue. It is also important to point out that one is able to speak for oneself. And this can be done as an individual or as a group or as an organization. And this is termed self-advocacy, and it gains increasing importance in autonomy of patients and also with empowerment of patients. Worldwide, the MS organizations have shown how powerful advocacy can be and how important the voice of patients and of carers can reach political institutions highest levels. And these highest levels are needed to proceed and to implement medical and social advances and improvements, and also to improve the fate of practical aspects of life, which are of equal or even more concern for patients and for carers. As we know, MS is presently experiencing an unprecedented form of incurable and often progressive disease towards a potentially curable or at least well-treated disease. This day reminds that MS patients and carers have globally paved the way for advocacy already, which could be the model for many advocacy strategies worldwide, also in other neurological diseases. With this, I invite you to join our World Brain Day. Thank you very much.
I'd like to thank all those associated with the production of this webinar, particularly MS International Federation and Ashley Logan and her team at Yakety Yak. I'd like to thank you, the attendees, for joining this webinar, for participating in the webinar, and for joining in the activities of this World Brain Day. It's important for the advocating for improvement in access to effective treatment, which will support and help those people living with MS and their carers. Together, we can halt MS-caused disability. We can remove the threat of being disabled and so improve the lives of those with MS. Thank you.